Well, I feel like Taylor Graham has separated himself in terms of consistency, but he's always been the second best quarterback of the day. So he's maybe elevated himself in terms of consistency, but he hasn't had a standout performance. As you mentioned, there's been a different guy with a standout performance every day. Maybe today was Kenny Guyton, who looked a little sharper than he had in the previous practices. Joe Bossierman was the standout Tuesday. Braxton Miller looked really good on Monday. Tuesday he regressed, and today he was somewhere in between.
All right, talking about practice, we're going to go on to the NCAA conference call you had.
Okay.
What did you get out of it, and did it sound like anything that would work?
There were a lot of proposals on the table that the NCAA plans to act on really soon. So what struck me was just the intense feeling that reform needs done.
Right.
And interestingly enough, Mark Emmert did say that instances like what happened at Auburn and what's going on at OSU were really an impetus for reform. So the Buckeyes have that going for them. They've been an inspiration to NCAA reformers everywhere. There's been a lot on the table, some with academics, some with paring down the rule book, some with enforcing the rule book more. And I'm a big fan of NCAA reform, a big fan of Mark Emmert, but one thing that he said today was really upsetting to me, and that was the fact that he says when it's not clear, when an NCAA investigation is over, it's usually the fault of the school. And that, to me, is not true at all. He said that cases are over when all the facts are known. But my question is, why can't we make it a little clearer when the fact-finding is done?
Well, isn't that... They said that one of the things they were trying to do is to make sure that now from, well, I guess, whenever they find out what they want to change, that that's going to be a part of their deal, is get things done faster, get decisions made faster. Because, you know, this decision that's going to be coming out with Ohio State, if it comes out in the middle of this season, mm-hmm. and then all of a sudden there's a bowl ban, I don't think that would be right. So did they propose any specifics of how they would change that?
No. And in fact, I think the NCAA believes the investigative process is fast enough usually as it is. They said the average investigation lasts 6 months. My issue would be more of, it's never clear when the investigation is over. And until the rumors die down, then there are all these recruiting battles being lost. There's all this these dark clouds of suspicion. And the NCAA could step in and put an end to that. They just don't.
Right.
So what happened today on the teleconference? You got the president, Mark Emmert, on there asking him about Ohio State and mm-hmm. investigating the program. Did you ask him directly about these rumors that are going on that the NCAA is still investigating Ohio State and that Friday will not be a end-all, be-all?
The NCAA won't discuss specific cases, so we asked him in general about the NCAA's process of investigating schools and clearing programs that can be cleared and punishing programs that need punished. And he still really didn't answer the question of what the NCAA can do to make that process more transparent and clear, and taking this sword that hangs over certain coaches' heads and removing that.
And so why do you always support the NCAA? I heard you say that earlier today. Why? Because I think they suck. That's just my personal opinion.
No, it's not just your opinion. I know it's a common perception, actually. I like the idea of the student athlete, and maybe that's naive and idealistic of me, but...
So you don't like the athlete student?
I do not like the athlete student. I don't like, major in basketball, or I'm going to major in volleyball.
You wouldn't be going to Ohio State if it wasn't for football. So when you look at it as an athlete, you're like, well, I'm going there. The only reason I'm going to this school is because they invited me to play football. So you don't...
I think that the percentage of athletes who go to a school to be an athlete first, the Greg Odens of the world, maybe mm-hmm. the Demetrius Stanleys of the world.
Yes, yeah.
I think that's a very small percentage of athletes as a whole than the Lori Schmidts of the world, who went to Ohio University to get an education and had that education funded in part by playing soccer. So I don't think you make rules based on the exceptions. I think you make rules based on the percentages. And the larger percentage of athletes are people who should be students first and who need an education if they want to get ahead in the world.
Right. Well, therein lies the problem, because I think a lot of people, and this is nothing against anybody in particular, but a lot of people, a lot of athletes don't really belong at a major university. They can't stay eligible. They haven't received the proper education in order to stay eligible, or they don't have the motivation to stay eligible. And you're right, Demetrius, that the football kind of fuels everything. But I agree with Lori to some extent that they're almost making it too easy, that these guys are getting into school on an athletic scholarship. And
that's not our fault, though. We're just taking our opportunity. But the thing is, one thing you got to understand is to get to the level of Ohio State or get to the NFL, you have to get your grades to be eligible. But everything you do every day you wake up is to find a way and do the things that's necessary to get you to that point.
Mm-hmm.
So if you don't focus on that stuff, you don't get to the NFL. You don't get to Ohio State. So as I'm looking at it and listening to you and understanding what you're saying, it's kind of a double-edged sword, because without that desire and that I'm going as an athlete, student second, you don't get those extra steps because you're not doing the extra stuff to get you there. You'd be doing more homework and more reading, so then you wouldn't get to Ohio State or to the NFL. So it's kind of the way it sounds. It's looking like a double-edged sword by the way you're talking and then I'm talking. I didn't know you did soccer. Look at you.
I did. I was a 5'2" goalie.
That's not usual. Usually goalies are pretty big.
No, right. Well, I wasn't very fast or athletic, but I would have run into anyone at any time.
You run into a brick wall
and knocked them over. So,
all right. Well, my questions are done with Lori, because we're gonna agree to disagree. I'm sure. Is that what's gonna happen, Lori?
Yeah, we're gonna have to agree to disagree.
Okay, I'm okay with that.
That's okay.
Lori, thanks for spending some time with us. Appreciate it. Glad you're getting after the NCAA a little bit. I just think it's always gonna be very vague. I know they're trying to get these guys in line and trying to get these schools to be able to police their players and programs better, but it just seems like as long as the NCAA is interested in making money and being a business, it's gonna be very tough for them to try to kill the golden goose, for the lack of a better phrase. I think they're trying to monitor it, trying to do what's right, trying to have the popular opinion and the perception that they care about the student athlete. But really, I think the hypocrisy of it sometimes is they care about their sponsors and the corporation and
money,
keeping everything brewing. So.
Money.
Well, they have to keep the programs funded. I mean, it's not like they can ignore the business aspects of it. So that's, to some degree, a necessary evil.
It always comes to money, Lori. Regardless.
Not in radio.
Well, that is true. Not in radio, but in the sports world, it comes down to that money and who's going to help them make more.
Straight cash, homie.
That's right.
You back at practice tomorrow?
Practice is not open tomorrow, but I will be keeping an ear out for what happens at the NCAA hearing.
Terrific. Hey, thanks for spending some time with us.
Thanks for having me.